Gandhi insisted that tyranny always falls, and truth and love is the heart of humanity and the universe. Heaven on Earth Creations has just completed two monumental documentaries on Mahatma Gandhi. But today, we would like for you to take a look at a montage we put together which tells about how important Gandhi's message is for the world and the global crises of today. Afterwards, we hope you will check out the link to our contribute page and make a contribution so that we can distribute these films throughout the world. Also, we will give you a free look at the complete Gandhi Awakening, a documentary about his early years in South Africa. Enjoy this. Time magazine named him the person of the 20th century, behind only Albert Einstein. Einstein famously said of Gandhi, "Generations to come, it may well be, will scarce believe that such a man as this one, ever in flesh and blood, walked upon this earth." The life and message of Mahatma Gandhi is even more essential to the survival of humankind today than in the 70 years since his assassination.
I feel in the inmost recesses of my heart that the world is sick unto death of blood spilling. The world is seeking a way out. When I am a perfect being, I will have to simply say the word. I want to attain that perfection by service.
At every point, Gandhi said, you've got to take that first step. And you've got to take that first step knowing that your first step will change the context for everyone else's first step.
Every morning I heard rifles exploding in innocent hamlets. There was nothing to justify the name rebellion. There was no resistance that one could see. My heart was with the Zulus, and I was delighted to hear that our main work was to be the nursing of wounded Zulus. The white soldiers tried to dissuade us from attending to the wounds, and as we would not heed them, they became enraged and poured unspeakable abuse upon the Zulus. And yet, those who perpetuated all those cruelties called themselves Christians. They were educated, better dressed than the Zulus, but not their moral superiors.
He has guilt. So guilt sharpens his reflections. And there he does get lots of ideas and possibilities about the future. And this is where he does conceive of some kind of non-violent struggle as an answer to violence.
I'm tired of the tension surrounding our day. I don't mind saying to you, I'm tired of living every day under the threat of death. I have no matter complex. I want to live as long as anybody in this building, and sometimes I begin to doubt whether I'm going to make it through. I must confess I'm tired. I'm tired of going to jail. I'm tired of all of the surging murmur of life's restless sea. So I'll tell anybody, I'm willing to stop marches. I don't march because I like it. I march because I must, and because I'm a man, and because I'm a child of God.
I have also called it love force or soul force. In the application of Satyagraha, I discovered in the earliest stages that pursuit of truth did not admit of violence being inflicted on one's opponent, but that he must be weaned from error by patience and compassion. And patience means self-suffering. So the doctrine came to mean vindication of truth, not by infliction of suffering on the opponent, but on oneself. The more I go about in these parts, the more I find that your worst enemy is fear. The terrorist as well as the terrorized is equally its victim. It eats into their vitals. Unless you cultivate fearlessness, there will never be any peace in these parts. My life is my message.
Well, Gandhi had this audacity. You know, I mean, how many people can say, my life is my message? I mean, it takes a lot of cheek to say that. Most of us would say, my life is not my message. My message is much greater than my poor, weak, terrible life. But this man has the guts to say, my life is my message. And he puts his life on the line. He makes it transparent.
He knew as he went into this darkness through his nonviolent commitment that he was going to be assassinated. It's a process that any prophet begins to realize.
If an explosion took place or somebody shot at me and I received his bullets on my bare chest, without a sigh and with Rama's name on my lips, only then you should say, I was a true Mahatma.
And of course he did.
The strongest impression I have is of the feeling of a loss by everybody. Not for a moment did I feel that it was a family bereavement. That thought never crossed my mind. Yes, I knew it was my grandfather who had been killed, but everybody was weeping and in grief that somebody very close to them had been killed. So that understanding that everybody was sharing this loss absolutely bowled me over. One death, willingly accepted, with forgiveness for the assassin, with the name of God in your heart and on your lips, made India a different country.